We don't usually get to say that in the UK. And so just before we start the official proceedings, I have the great pleasure of being able to announce the winner of this year's RES Prize. So this is a prize that is chosen by the president of the RES in conjunction with the editors and another elected member of the RES for what we deem to be one of the best papers that's been published in the EJ this year. And so this year, I'm very pleased to announce the winner is Mao Ji Yu for his paper, Processing Trade, Tariff Reduction, and Firm Productivity, Evidence from Chinese Firms. So this is a really nice paper that explores the effects of tariff reductions on imported inputs and on final goods on productivity. So firm-level inputs and output tariffs are constructed using highly disaggregated trade data and firm data from 2000 to 2006. The paper pays very careful attention to issues of endogeneity arising from self-selection of firms into processing activities and of firm-level tariffs. The findings suggest that both types of tariff reductions have a positive impact on productivity, but that they are weaker on the firm's share of processing imports grows. So the impact of input tariff reductions on productivity improvement is weaker than on output tariff reduction. And by adding firm productivity to economy-wide productivity, both tariff reductions are found to contribute around 42% to firm productivity growth for firms in the sample and at least 13.5% to economy-wide productivity growth. So what we really liked about this paper was it's a very important topic because most of the existing literature has tended to focus on the effects of trade liberalization through reductions in output tariffs, while this paper also looks at the effects of lower tariffs on imported intermediate goods. And it pays very careful attention to issues of measurement and endogeneity, and the rich data set allows the authors to investigate both effects in a clear and detailed manner. So I'd really encourage you all to have a look at that paper, and I'd like to now invite the author, Mao Ji Yu, to come up and accept the award. Congratulations. Okay, so now it's my great pleasure to be able to introduce the EJ speaker for this year, who really needs very little introduction, is Esther Duflo. Esther is the Abdul Latif Jameel Professor of Poverty Alleviation and Development Economics at MIT. She's the co-founder and director of the Poverty Action Lab, JPAL, and her research seeks to understand the economic lives of the poor with the aim of helping to design and evaluate social policies. So Esther was the winner of the John Bates Clark Medal in 2010, among a large number of other awards and prestigious prizes that she's won. And recently she's been one of the founding editors of the American Economic Journal Economic Policy, which I think has been a great innovation and has had a really big impact on the way the economics is translated into policy action. And I think Esther's really to be applauded for her hard work on that. So anyway, you've come to hear Esther, not me, so I'll stop talking now and ask Esther to come up and tell us about randomized evaluation as a guide to policy progress and challenges. Esther.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for having me. It's a great honor. I'm very pleased to be here today. I think about 10 years ago, I was on a panel at one of these conferences where I discussed a little bit about randomized evaluation. And in the meantime, I had sort of stopped doing that, giving sort of general speeches about randomized evaluation because I was getting a little bit tired of delivering the stump speech. And then when John Moore contacted me last year, I thought maybe it's a good occasion actually to get back to a general talk on randomized evaluations because it's been a few years now and we can do a bit more than stump speech in the sense that we can be a little bit more reflective about what we have achieved, where the difficulties are, and in particular I want to focus on the potential challenges to go from results from particular evaluations to any policy action. So what is my main tools? It's randomized controlled trials. You take a study sample and you randomly assign people to groups, any number of groups. Usually there is a comparison group, although it's not necessary. It's not actually always the case. And then various kind of treatment. You don't have to randomize. Like the simplest way to randomize is to ask your computer to draw a coin for you. So this is what it does, and to just separate people into the various people or communities. You can randomize, of course, at various levels. You can randomize at the individual level, at the cluster level, etc. The easiest way is just to do it in this very simple way, and then the people in the rounds are the treatment group, and the people who don't get the round are the control groups, and then you're going to be collecting the same kind of data for both both types of groups. But it's not always feasible to do that or desirable to do that. And there are other ways to do that, to randomize, that people have been experimenting over the years that have some have good properties, some have less good properties, but at least there are a possibility to introduce randomization. First thing you could do is to say, well, you could be in a situation where full randomization in the entire population is not possible. So a clear example is if you're interested in bank loans. So you have an organization that is lending money to firms, and they're just not going to lend to anybody who shows up at their doorstep. That's not going to happen. And on the other hand, if they are profit-making, there are loans that they really want to make. So they are not going to deny credit to people for random reasons either. So in that case, something that has been pioneered by Dean Carl and his collaborators is to say, well, let's use whatever scoring method is used to group people into credit-worthy and not credit-worthy, and let's separate. So some group of people will be getting the credit anyway. Some group of people will be rejected anyway. And then there is a group sort of around the cutoff. Sometimes people call this randomization in the bubble. There is a group around the cutoff where you can randomize. And again, you don't have to randomize 50-50. As long as you know what is the assignment rule, you can properly analyze the data. For example, in the example I give here, is 85% treatment group in the good group, the people who are above the normal threshold, and only 60% treatment in the other group. You could imagine whatever. Then, of course, you're going to restrict your analysis to the people in the bubble, and you're going to account for the strata you are in order to account for the fact that the randomization probability depends on the score. Other method to randomize that has been actually very popular and is a little bit less now is to exploit the phasing of programs. So this is, for example, the way that Progressa was randomized in Mexico, one of the first very large-scale policy evaluation, which was done in collaboration with the government with a very clear sense of what was politically feasible or not. So the way they did that is to say, okay, we're going to treat everybody eventually, that's the goal, but we're going to start by some community and then include the next community. So the way it works here then is, for example, in the first year, the group A is treated and group B is the comparison group and group C is the comparison group. In year two, you bring in group B, and in year three, everybody is brought in. One clear advantage of this way of doing things is that it's quite palatable, because usually there is anyway a natural phase-in of stuff. Like governments don't have, or even partners, NGO partners, firms, whatever, don't have infinite capacity to do things, especially at the beginning, and therefore it's kind of quite natural to do things progressively, and then why not randomize if you're going to do things progressively? So that's why it's quite a popular way to do things. There are a couple of disadvantages. The first one is that it is not clear what people in the comparison group expect, and it is not clear whether those expectations potentially affect the behavior that before they get treated. So in the case of Progressa, for example, there are two structural papers on Progressa. one by Todd and Walpin, and one by Athanasio Megios. And they have, they make different assumptions on this very question. And I don't think this is really a debate that is easily solvable. So both papers are published, you know, it's fine. But it matters whether or not you assume that the treatment group knows, the comparison knows that treatment is forthcoming, and therefore, for example, they might delay investment or they might prepone them or whatever. And we just don't know. So that's one issue is that. Another issue is that people, organizations get better at implementing programs over time. So the version of the program that is implemented in the second year is not necessarily exactly the version of the program that was implemented in the first year. And it gets a little bit tricky when you're trying to compare what's happening in year one and year two as the different groups got treated. Another method that is very important, that also has its lots of methodological problems, but plays a key role, is that of encouragement design, where you might be in a situation where there is already a program that's universal anyway. We take, for example, the old age pension program in India for old people, old destitute people, everybody is eligible for it. So if you are interested in evaluating this program, you're not about to deny it to anybody. You cannot introduce it because it's already there. On the other hand, there are many people who are not taking up the pension because they're not aware of it, because they didn't get around to apply, because applying is complicated and the like. So there one could imagine something like going to a treatment group, to forming a sample of old people, randomly sample the people who are, among people who are eligible, figuring out from your initial sampling of these old people who would be eligible for the pension. Those who are already getting it are out of the study for this purpose. Those who are not getting it but are eligible for it, you can help them jump through the hoops and try and sign them up for the program. So maybe the sign-up rate will go from 20%, which is what people, old eligible people would end up finding their way to the office anyway, in 20% of the cases if you don't talk to them, but maybe with bright, you know, volunteers helping them to sign up, it will go up to 45%. So here, the intention to treat would be to compare the entire treatment group to the entire comparison group. So that's the only thing that is randomized, so that's the only core comparison that you can do. That's legitimate to do. But of course, this is not the effect of the pension in the example that I just gave. It's the effect of trying to help you to get a pension. If we want to go from one to the other, we need to divide by the fraction of, by the difference in the fraction of people who actually get the pension in the treatment and the comparison group. So I would get my outcome, say I'm interested in the effect of getting a pension on cognitive decline among the elderly. So I would take the difference in cognitive scores and then divide that by, in my example, 25 percentage points. So what does randomization bias? It bias a handle on causality. It bias a number of things. So first of all, it biases a handle on causality. I should say at the outset that I'm not very interested in, I'm interested in the causal effect of a policy or an intervention, and I'm much less interested in the causes of effect. So I'm interested in the effect of causes and not very interested in the causes of effect. I mean, it's not that I'm not interested in causes of effect. I would love to know the causes of effect, but I don't think we are well set up to do that. I think maybe that's the objective of physics as a science. I'm not even sure that is the case, but I think that is the case. You talk to physicists and you have the impression that they are trying to build an entire model of the universe. But I think for economics, it's a bit of a difficult proposition. So even though that would be the hope, that's not what I try to do. I think it's at least above, it's much above our pay grade. So all we can hope, or all I can hope to do, is to try and get the effect of causes, and randomization gives you that. What happens in this particular sample if I do this versus if I do that? And randomization is a natural way, although I should say not the only way, but a natural way to provide a credible counterfactual for what happened to a particular treatment group. So in the Rubin invents notation, what randomization buys you for sure is that the value of the potential outcome untreated for people in a treatment group is the same as, in expectation, is the same as the expected value of the potential outcome untreated for the control group. So this is what this equation says. And therefore, the difference between the outcome in the treated group and in the control group is, in fact, the average causal effect. Now, there are a number of other ways you could get that. So randomization is not the only way to get that. As people have pointed out recently, for example, Max Casey, and then Banerjee, Chesson, and Snowberg in another paper, you could also say, as long as you have any known assignment mechanism, you could control for it. So you could just say that this person is going to be treated and that person is going to be treated. So it's not that randomization is the only way to do that. So what is another thing? So you could just, as long as you control, as long as the assignment is a known function of the covariates, then that's just as good as randomizing. So a question, interesting question that Max Casey pointed out is why do you want to randomize? You can do much better given the question you're interested in by assigning very purposefully, doing the opposite of randomizing. One intuition for that is suppose you had only two schools and you in your sample, you're headmasters, you're only two schools. And you're interested in trying a new method in a school and then rather than the other. So intuitively, you don't want to randomize. Intuitively, you want to put your treatment in the school where if you think that the treatment is going to really work in schools where the test scores are already high, for example, if that is your prior, then you might say, well, then it depends on what is your objective. If your objective is to show that the program can work, then you're going to assign the treatment in the schools where the scores are already high. If your objective is to show that the program will work even in the worst case scenario, then you can assign treatment in the schools where the test scores are low to start with. The point is that with two schools, there is very little you can learn from the expectations anyway, so you want to use your prior to the maximum extent possible. So why would you want to randomize? The more general point that Casey is making is if you're in a Bayesian framework, you never want to randomize. You want to, you know, this is true as the example that I gave with two schools, I think it's very intuitive for us to think about, but in a larger, even in a larger setting, it remains the case that why would you randomize? You have some priors that should guide you on telling you where you should assign the different treatment, and then you're going to learn a maximum amount from the one manipulation that you have. What Banerjee, Chesson, and Snowberg show is that, well, that's fine if you're only interested in finding out for yourself. But the moment you're trying to communicate to an audience, the audience has different priors. Everybody in the audience have different priors. So a very natural thing you might want to do is not just to convince yourself, but to convince the most skeptical person in your audience. And what they show is that if people come up with different priors, and your objective is to convince the most skeptical person in the audience that, in fact, what you're getting from the difference between treatment and control in the actual assignment that you did is indicative of what the average causal treatment effect is, you want to randomize. And so that's the sort of another reason, completely separate reason to randomize in a way, is that even you know, compared to other known assignment mechanisms, randomization gives us robustness against, if you will, the fact that people have different views in the world. Sort of layman's way to describe that is that it's very transparent what you are doing. There is no, it's pretty obvious. You just randomize, maybe you randomize within strata, so do it very, very simply. And the analysis is also very, very simply, and therefore communicating with the public and with policymakers is also very easy. So one question that might ask is why bother? is an economic theory there to guide us on what may be the important factors, factors that may actually be difficult to manipulate in our cities. For example, we might be interested in, say, the impact of democracy on economic growth might seem to be a much more important question than whether or not we should, to take an example that I worked on, whether kids should be tracked or not tracked by ability in classrooms seems kind of a more important question, bigger question. Don't we have reasons to think that education is important? Don't we have reasons to think that the rule of law is important, macroeconomic stabilities or the like? Shouldn't we focus on this type of stuff that we cannot randomize anywhere? Are we likely to confine ourselves to the small things that that are unlikely to make a major difference in practice when we randomize? Another thing that's sort of has been brought up is maybe by requiring randomization to really be confident that some particular intervention has a causal effect of such magnitude, you are stifling innovation because you can't randomize every 5 minutes, and it's like you can't randomize every possible, you count the kind of millennial version of saying that you can't crawl the design space by if you're trying to randomize everything. So isn't that an issue? And here what I would say is that fine, all of these are, these big questions are important, but another thing that I found in my work to be very important is that the details are incredibly important as well, at a level of detail that's called a little bit frightening. That when you go deeper and deeper into very specific rules and changes of these rules, you realize how much they make a difference. And for that, I want to use an example that's actually not from my work and it's not from NRCT, but I think illustrate why, for the time being, I will continue to do what I am doing, which is looking at details, in a sense, and looking at the impact they had, which is a paper by Thomas Fujiwara on electoral rules in Brazil that some of you may have seen. So he looks at a reform in Brazil that led to a change in the way that people choose who to vote for. So Brazil is a big country, it's a very open democracy, lots of people compete for elections, and so that the result is a little bit complicated. So before his reform, what you had is that, for example, in this particular election, you were choosing for two people. You were voting for two people for different offices. The prefect and the vereador. For the prefeito, it's complicated enough. You have several candidates. You need from different parties, and you need to pick one. For the vereador, it's even harder because there are so many that they don't fit into one list. So you had to go to a book and figure out who you want to vote for and write down their number without a mistake. And with any mistake in that ballot, then the ballot is invalid. Then they changed the system. The objective of changing the system was to be able to count the vote a little bit faster. And they changed the system to one where you went to this big book and you punched the number of the person you want to vote for. So first of all, if you punch the wrong number, it goes, it gives you a cross, so you know that you've not voted for someone who doesn't exist. Second of all, when you punch the correct number, you see his like picture. He looks very engaging. You definitely want to vote for him. And then when you're sure that's the guy, you can confirm, okay? And what he looks at is the impact that introducing this change had, not on how quickly they counted the ballot, which was the objective, but on the number of ballots that are valid, and then downstream consequences on political choices. So I'll show you the results, very clear results on the number of votes that are valid, and I'll tell you the rest of the stories later. So if you look at the green dots, this is 1994, so this is before the system was introduced anywhere. And what you see is that the number of, this is the fraction of valid votes divided by, the number of valid votes divided by the turnout. And you see that you have about between 65 and 70 percent valid vote. So that's like a lot of votes that are invalid, a lot of errors. Some of them might not be errors in the sense people might have decided not to vote for anybody, but there's good reasons to think that some of them are off. Then in 1998, what they did is introduce the system on the pilot basis for the big cities only. So there is a discontinuity at 40,000 registered voters in a city. And at the discontinuity, you see that the smaller cities are not on the system yet. So they still have a lot of invalid votes. The bigger cities are on a new system. And there is a big jump, about maybe 15 percentage points improvement in the fraction of valid vote at the discontinuity. And then in 2002, they introduced it everywhere, and now the discontinuity disappears because the small city gets brought in there. So what you see is that this was not the intent of this program. It was just a change in sort of the technology of the election, but it really had a big impact on the number of valid votes. And what's more, the number, of course, who is likely to make a mistake? Well, I would be making mistakes because I can't get two numbers right, but without reversing them. But most people who would make mistakes are people whose literacy level is not very high. So when you look at the, so what you should expect is not only it's an increase in number of valid votes, but it's a change effectively in the median voter, because the median voter moves towards the less educated people. And how can you verify that? Well, you can see who is elected. And you can see that post the reform, are the people who get elected, when you compare the blue city towards the threshold, the elected people are less likely to be educated, they are more likely to be left-wing, etc., in the new system. So there is an enfranchisement of poorer people, which led to a change in who is voting for. Moreover, when you look at these people are elected to represent a province. So some in the intermediate period, depending on the number of smaller city and bigger city in the place, more or less of this the system was more or less important in different provinces. And he uses that to look at whether it also makes a difference in the type of expenditure that these places make, and he does find a shift of the budgetary expenditure towards pro-poor policies when the system gets introduced. So this is like, you would think this is like the most technical, not very important change, and yet you have the entire downstream effects of something like that. So it's just an example to tell you that how critical details are. And when we are trying to answer the big questions, we cannot really answer them without answering what goes inside them at the level of the details. So that's kind of what we're trying to do, and slowly but surely trying to blanket the place by having as many details as possible. So today, JPAL is a network of researchers. So today we have about 700 RCTs that are either completed or in the field. Most of them are in the field. And there are, of course, many, many more that are completed by people who are not from DEEPA. So what I want to do now is to ask four key questions that come up after 15 years of doing this work on the 700 project, which are more to do with the usefulness of this approach for policy purpose. The first one, which is, of course, essential, and which is a purely empirical question, is whether results would generalize from context to context. So what you get from a well-designed experiment, well-implemented experiment, is the effect of a particular intervention in some particular sample. But what does it tell you about whether it would have effect elsewhere? Sort of depends on how heterogeneous we are and societies are and stuff like that, and whether it would matter for results. So I'll give you two examples where we start knowing a little bit more on that because there is a bit more systematic attempt to do the same thing in different places. So the first example I want to give you is this, the very type of example where you really want to try the same thing in several places because And the program you are testing is complicated and the underlying theory is a little bit, maybe it's hard to understand exactly what's going on because many things are going into the broth at the same time. So it's a program which was pioneered by BRAC in Bangladesh, called Targeting the Ultra Poor, which is sort of a big push approach at the individual level or the household level. So the idea is that they are targeting people who are not taking up microcredit, who are not interested or not, are considered to be not suitable for microcredit. And they are doing a lot of investment on them for a year and then letting them go and hoping that the effect persists over time, if any. So what are they doing? They select the beneficiaries via participatory resource approvals, appraisals of the poorest people in the village, and then they provide them with an asset that's the key. So typically, it's a couple of cows. Could be 4 goats, it could be enough to start a business, etc. Then they visit them every week. They give them technical skill training. They give them a stipend for a few weeks to so that the people are not tempted to eat the cow right away. And they force them to save, and they give them some health training. So that's the idea. That program was evaluated by Robin Burgess, Oriana Bandiera, and Imran Razul in Bangladesh itself with BRAC in a large-scale, very well-done evaluation. And they found large impact of this program. But at the same time that they were conducting this evaluation, there was already the idea is that both by BRAC and by the supporter of this program, it's like, suppose they show it works, and then, you know, what? Like, we know BRAC is a good organization, they can do good stuff, but will it scale up or not? So what we did is that, under the leadership of Dean Carlin set up, on parallel to everywhere but Bangladesh, 6 other RCTs of the BRAC model together. So the way it worked is that the BRAC people went to the different sites to speak to potential partners and create sort of a locally relevant version of a program with the same philosophy. So the program changes from place to place, but if you want, you keep the same kind of concept and you adapt it. And then we had 6 teams separately doing the work, and we published 1 paper. You have to be a little bit patient. But then the paper is in Science, which doesn't mean anything for economists, but for if you have a science envy like me, it's nice. And this is what we found overall in the entire sample. So this is across type of domains, if you want. This is zero, and this is the standardized effect size with the standard errors that are adjusted for the fact that we have several outcomes that we are testing together. And you can see that it is really striking that for all of the domains you look at, you have improvements. Of course, for livestock revenue, you have lots of improvement, but then when you give cows to people, so what it shows is that people haven't sold them. This is after 3 years. So the program lasts for a year, so this is 2 years later. This is pooling all of the sites together. But what is more interesting is that you can look at the same thing country by country and seeing the extent to which you have heterogeneity or not country by country. And you have one country where it didn't work at all. The assets by the end of N-line 2 are not lower, not higher. Ex post, you can always make up a story for that country, but I'm going to refrain on that. But in the other countries, you can see that all of them are positive. This is for assets and for consumption, same thing. Again, Honduras has the same like negative result, all of them. So it gives you a sense that this large effect that we are finding are not just due to one place that is pulling the results, but are there in every country. So it gives you a sense that it's a program that works, implemented by very different people in very different contexts, as long as it maintains this sort of core philosophy. Another example of trying the same thing in several places was not done. It just happened that several teams were working together. Is microcredit. So microcredit was all the rage in the 2000s, where there was a lot of very positive coverage. Mohamed Yunus got the Nobel Prize, etc. And at that time, like, several of us were very interested in trying to evaluate, get a chance to do a randomized evaluation of microcredit, but it was very difficult because microcredit organizations were not at all interested. They thought they were having a good ride anyway, and they just didn't see the point. But nonetheless, progressively, people managed to convince them. Orazio Atanasio Costas Meglio worked in two countries, and I worked in two countries, and other worked in other countries. So eventually, by 2015, there were six evaluations together, plus one that already had been published by Dean Carlin on evaluation of microcredit organization, with one of two designs, either randomization in the bubble at the applicant level, like the way I described before, or expansion as the groups were expanding, making microcredit available in some places and not some others. So cluster level randomization, where the point is availability. The first study that came out was India. It found very indifferent results, let's say, not very many positive numbers at all. And those results were attacked, perhaps rightly, for being not very representative because it was in Hyderabad, which is a very booming city, and maybe this is not what microcredit was for. So we just sat there and waited until more results came out. And eventually, by the way, in the meantime, the mood on microcredit really changed. So from the super excitement of the 2000s, it became like, is microcredit founder Mohamed Yunus a bloodsucker of the poor? And the study came out, and they were kind of in the middle, which is it doesn't seem to be parting, and it doesn't seem to be so great. So this is the effect. When I saw the study were coming up, in fact, several were published, were submitted to the AEJ applied, and I thought, let me put them together in one issue, even though they came separately. Let me, since they're coming my way anyway, I just grabbed the one that had not been submitted before, to put them into one place, asking the authors to, of course, make their data available, and to publish the same tables. Now, the text, they could say whatever narrative they wanted, but at least the same set of tables is available for all studies with uniformly defined outcomes. Because people who do randomized evaluation collect data work in the end with, you know, reasonably standardized methods by now, pretty serious about collecting data. You can do that because the way the data is collected allows to do that. So all of the data is available on the AEA website, and at the time this was the universe of microcredit studies, and since then there might be some more. What you have in blue are for profit, the point estimate of the effect study by study, along with the 95% confidence interval and the small interval in the box, the 50% interval and the 95% confidence. So the blue are just the OLS, so it replicates from the study. And the advantage of having all these studies coming together is that you can start asking yourself, to what extent are these studies different? To what extent are they similar? So I didn't show you for Ultra Poor, although they are starting to do this study, but what I have here in red is some work by a MIT PhD student, Rachel Meager, where she's using Bayesian hierarchical methods to combine, if you want, the study. So what is it doing? It's very simple. It's saying the Bayesian part is, you know, you can, it's just a tool at this point. It is not, it is not very, there's no philosophical differences, it's just a tool. What it does is to say, well, suppose that all of these point estimates in every site are coming from a parent distribution of possible treatment effect, which itself has some distribution. So it could be that all of the studies are, all of the point estimates in every single country are very similar, all of the real treatment effects are very similar to each other, or it could be that there is a huge diversity in the world. So there is this parent distribution, which we are going to assume to be normal, with some mean treatment effect for the study and some distribution around it. And in addition, of course, every randomized evaluation has its own specific sample, so it comes with its own point estimate. So what you can do when you have the 7 studies is to say, well, let me see to what extent the studies want to tell me that they are all the same, they're coming from very similar treatment effect or very dissimilar treatment effect. And then once I assume this little bit of structure, I can also shrink the variability to say these are the because I can take advantage of the fact that I have a much larger sample when I take all the studies together than if I had them individually. So I'm not assuming that the treatment effect is the same everywhere. I'm assuming that it comes from this parent distribution. And what she finds is that basically all of the studies really want to pool, and they want to pool at zero. So there is a lot of university here, uniformity here for the mean treatment effect on profit, and it's really close to zero. This is something, then you can do the same for consumption, and you're finding the same again, where all of the studies want to pull at zero. Interestingly, what she's working on now is to look at the impact on the variability of outcome as opposed to the mean outcome. And there she finds no pooling actually, which is, she finds that in some studies, microcredit seems to result in huge variance of outcomes. And in some studies, it seems to not result in huge variance of outcome. So the fact that she finds no pooling on the mean effect is not a general theorem. Even in this context, you can actually find a lot of diversity of the impact of microcredit on variability. But this is the type of thing that one can now do. Incidentally, to do this type of these basic studies, you don't need the microdata. All you need is the mean, the sample size, and the standard error of the estimates. Of course, with the microdata, you can do much more. For example, looking at effects by subgroups and the like, but even with just the mean and the standard error, you can do a lot, which might bring you to the question, well, how do I access the data on the universe of what has been found unless you've published it in the AED, which is not going to happen again. And here the answer is an institutional answer, which is how do we make sure that we access, it's very important for asking this type of question of the extent to which particular results generalize or not, and therefore, and what's what can we predict for future sites based on what we already have done, etc. So one study is certainly not going to be enough, but if you took the universe of published studies, it's not going to be enough either, because published studies are not representative of studies in general. And I'm an editor, so I'll take some of the blame for that, or maybe not other blame. It's normal. You publish stuff that are interesting for a reason or another, but things that are interesting for people to read in a journal is not necessarily the universe of studies. So how do we access the universe of study? So this is something that I've been working on with the American Economic Association on a more institutional level, which is to establish a registry of randomized experiments. So now if you type AEA registry, you will land up on a website where you can see, I think as of today, about 600 studies have been registered. And ideally, my hope, it's very, very easy to register a study. So it's not a pre-analysis plan that is going to tie your hands. It is very, very easy to register a study. You're saying, I'm studying microcredit in such and such country, and my main outcome that I'm interested in is the effect of profit. So that's about it. So it's like about 10, 15 questions, trying to hope to get near universality of report, of registering of the studies. And therefore, when someone wants to do a meta-analysis or some exercise like that, they can, in principle, find out the universe of what has been attempted, what's never been finished, which of course is not going to lead to any result, but what has been finished and not published. Usually, you cannot do an RCT without a funder, and you cannot get money without writing a report. So there is always some trace. So even if something doesn't get published, you always have the result available somewhere, which means that we will be able to do much more, many more of this stuff moving forward. I think it's, by the way, very interesting, just as a methodological, there's lots of open questions on what can be done, what's the best way to aggregate these studies, etc. And there will be a lot of such studies to aggregate in the future. So that's for generalizability. I think it's still an open question. Of course, I gave you two examples where things seem to pool quite nicely, but they could be, because these are the ones that we have so far, but there might be differences elsewhere. A second question you can ask is whether, suppose you have a successful program, you can even have a successful program that has been replicated by several NGOs, so you're willing to believe that it's a successful program. Can it be mainstream into government, which is often the objective at the end of the day, is to show sort of test drive policy without too much loss in transmission? And there you have several questions. First of all, the effect might be different for a small program or a large one because of equilibrium effects. Second, as the program is scaled up, we may be moving down the demand curve in the sense that maybe the first people that you treat are the people who would benefit the most from the program, but then as you expand it, it's the benefit, the marginal person has lower and lower benefits. And the third problem is governments may not be able to implement a policy as well as an NGO partner who is presumably selected in some sense, especially if they were willing to be part of an experiment. So how do we deal with these issues? There is really no way to deal with these issues except to tackle them. You can't just think about them in the abstract and think, well, maybe they are problems. Because, well, yes, maybe they are problems, but the only way to know is to try. So I think from a kind of a test, from a program that you test in 1, 2, or 5, or 6, or 7, well done, relatively well-controlled field experiments. The next step has to be a much larger scale, working with government RCGs, or sometimes it can even be the first step, because this is how you're going to be tackling all these issues at once, and they are going to creep up otherwise. So many of our researchers are now engaged into this at-scale evaluation of policy intervention where all of these factors start to play out. And there are many examples. Paul Gerhardt has been doing that for a long time. Kartik Moralidharan is doing that a lot today. I'll give you one example that I was involved with, which is specifically interested in the issue of equilibrium effects. So this is work that I've done with Bruno Crépon, Philippe Zamora, Roland Ratlow, and Luc Berger. So what we are interested in this is this question, this policy that is very popular in European countries as a way of fighting unemployment or trying to help the unemployed is active labor market policies. So basically, it's usually contracting with an interim agency, or sometimes the unemployment agencies do it themselves, to try and coach the unemployed workers to help them find a job. So you call for them an employer, you teach them to tie their tie, you build their resumes, etc. So it's actually pretty expensive. It's 2,000, the policy we look at is 2,000 euros just to get, for the agency to take on a case, 2,000 euros when they have found a job, 2,000 euros if they stay for 6 months. And this is on top of whatever other services people are receiving, so it's not cheap. And there have been some evidence that there is some effect, nothing to write home about, but there is some positive effect of this policy in the sense that the people who are helped get a job a little bit quicker than people who are not, etc. But the question is that is whether this is a game of musical chair, which is I get Richard Jobs, but he stayed unemployed a little bit longer. So when I compare, if I'm a treated person, Richard is a controlled person, then I will do better than him, but it's not that there are more jobs on average, it's purely redistribution from him to me. Or is it the case that somehow it improves the efficiency of the matching process, it improves the efficiency of the search effort such that there is at least some amount of extra jobs that are generated, or higher quality jobs or the like. So the only way you can know that is to try and randomize at the market level. So we worked with the unemployment agency in France to randomize at 2 levels in a large cross-section of France, about half of the country. So we first randomized at the labor market level, French people don't move all that much, so it's about the town constitute a nice labor market. And first, we randomize at that level, which is treated at what level, and then within each labor market, who is treated. So you randomize at two levels. So specifically, we have these five groups. In one group of cities, nobody is treated. In one group of cities, 25% of people are treated, 50%, 75%, and 100%. And the main contrast we are interested in is the treated people versus the controlled people within a community, and the controlled people versus the controlled people across treatment intensity. So basically, from the point of view of people who are not treated themselves, the fraction of people treated around them is a treatment. So I want to look at the effect of that. And if someone gets hurt by the fact that more people around them are treated, it's going to give me an idea that there is some this equilibrium impact. So the first thing you can do is replicate what other people have done, which is randomization within sites. So this is the comparison, for example, between this blue person and this white people. And what you find when you do that is that for overall in the sample, but it's driven particularly by men, people are 5 percentage points more likely to have found a job, a fixed-term contract job, like a good job within 6 months, if they were helped. It's not a ridiculous effect. It goes from 17% to 22%. But the second thing you want to do then is to say to add back the control group, compare the control group to the control group in the completely untreated places. And when you do that, you realize that being assigned to program makes people better off, but being in a program area makes people worse off. When you add these two, it's like it's almost zero. So basically, on average for the sample, there is essentially you cannot reject the hypothesis that it's purely a reallocation from one person to another. What is interesting is we were lucky in the timing that some of the sample is from before the Great Recession, some of it is from during the Great Recession, and you see that these externality impacts are much larger during the recession than before. Where it may, you would think that there is probably some shortage of jobs in the first place. So it tells you something beyond the general, beyond these particular issues. It can also help you think about how UI should be structured, for example, because you would think that if there is basically no, if all my search effort, think of this as making your search effort more effective, if my search effort is largely an externality on another guy, then there is not much loss in discouraging people from exercising search effort, and I can just, there's very little cost in increasing UI in periods of recession, which in addition is nice smoothing properties. So from this type of things, this little aside, from this type of things, we can also learn parameters that can be useful to think about the world in general and not just this particular policy. It also suggests that this particular policy is a little bit of a waste of time. So this is really not unique. There are several such programs that have been tried in the past few years. For example, Kartik Mohalidharan has done a nice study on a smart card intervention for payment of wages in a public works program, where they look at the smart card program was implemented at the sort of labor market level within a large level, at the block level within India, within district in India. So it's pretty large, and it led to it made the program much more effective. So it led to an increase in take up. And then what they look at is wages, and they find that it leads to an improvement in wages in the private sector, an increase in wages for casual labor, which is the direct competition to the public works program, such that the effect, when you calculate the benefits for the poor people, the effect coming from the increase on the of the wages in the private sector for the poor completely dwarfs the direct effect of the program. So it's not a nice, it's not a theoretical nicety, this general equilibrium effect. They are there, they matter. What is also interesting in this case is they find that agricultural productivity went up when you increase the wages. which also indicates that there is probably some monopsony power by employer of casual labor. They're basically underpaid, and when you are forced to pay them a bit more, probably take some rent away from the owner, but increase productivity. We have a recent paper that we are working on with Carter, where we provide something that has been tested by various people to give information to young people about the career of graduates from different schools. So people have done that already. They found that people are responsive in general to such information. But what we look at is by randomizing, again, the fraction of people who get it within a schooling market, we look at the response of the schools. And what we find is the good schools expand capacity, the bad schools cut prices. So there is an effect on the on supply response you can study. The other issue that we need to be working on is this issue of the ability of governments to actually implementing programs. Scaling up in government is an entire different ball game than doing things yourself, even with an NGO partner. We have an example here of trying to scale up a successful remedial education intervention, where it took us about 10 years to go from an intervention that works when implemented by an NGO to an intervention that can be mainstreamed into the government without being lost in transmission. So by trying and error and failing and trying again. So I'm not claiming this is easy. And in a sense, that is the these plumbing questions are also very interesting in and of themselves, you know, but they are more almost about the economics of organizations than about the economics of what you're studying in the first place. Because you know what you want to implement, the government wants to implement it, but the transmission of going from the sort of idea at the top to what it's going to become at the bottom is terribly complicated. And it's all in the details to work it out. So this is a lot, I'm doing a lot of this work now, which is interesting and a little bit frustrating at times. The third question you want to ask is whether any of that matters. Is there any appetite by policymakers and others to scale up evidence from successful pilot trials? So the proof of the pudding is in the numbers. We try to track down the fraction of people who are covered by policies that some of our network has evaluated, and it's kind of a lot of people now. And how does it work? It works in two ways. Sometimes by almost directly, because you've worked with the government, shown that it worked, and therefore they can scale up. So the key example is Progressa, which was pre-Jipal, where it was done immediately with the government. The evaluation was successful, and therefore it scaled up. So we have some post examples of that. Another situation is when people work with an... how am I doing for time?
So
you
have 15 minutes.
OK, great, perfect. Another situation is when you've worked with the... So that's the progress I was an example of that. I'm going to skip this one to leave some time. The other situation is where someone evaluates a program and then someone runs with it and does the effort to kind of make it adopted by others. So this is Pascaline Dupa. Probably you know her already. What she did for her dissertation is to pilot a program called Sugar Daddy, which to convince young girls that young boys are less likely to be infected with HIV than older men. And she showed in her, on a small scale, that it had a large impact in reducing pregnancies of young girls with older men, which is nice in itself, but also is probably very good for the transmission of HIV, so basically indicate. So she did that, and then sort of no one did anything with it for a while. She was busy doing other stuff, etc. And just a couple of years ago, this is Noam Angres. He, after graduating from MIT, he went to Botswana for a couple of years on a fellowship, and he decided that he was going to take that on. He's now studying at Oxford as a Rhodes Scholar, and he's a very successful organization called Young Love that is working with governments to try to replicate that study and every time evaluate it. So this doesn't have to be like within academia. It can be. So to say that, it doesn't happen mechanically. When it's the government who's done the evaluation, there is a direct pathway to scale up. And a lot of the numbers that I showed you in the table before, they come from that, from working with the government and expanding. If not, it takes a little bit more effort, and someone has to be willing to do that. But there are people who are looking for scale now, and that's the way to do that. The last question is the extent to which I believe, in order to have influence in a more sustainable way, as academic, we not only need to show people like this, you can do this or you can do that, but you need to be able to foster some culture change within governments, or you know, for in other settings it would be within firms, etc. So that people learn, these organizations learn how to think themselves. And so the next question is then whether there is any appetite by policymakers and others to integrate a culture of learning and experimentation into their own program, which I think is going to be critical because precisely because of what I was saying, which is you can't really understand the problem that you're going to face when you're at scale unless you're already at scale. You can get sort of interesting insight from experiments, but you can't really do policy from experiments. So you, in order to do policy from experiments, you do have to do experiment within the policy setting. And for that to happen, you have to have partners who are willing to do it, and ideally who are able to do it without substantial amount of babysitting. So is there any appetite by policymakers and others to do that? I believe there is. It's a little bit more like kind of on a case-by-case basis, enterprising people, et cetera, within government. But I'll give you one example where it worked very nicely. This is work that I've done with Rohini Pandey and Michael Grinsell and Nick Ryan in Gujarat. And we were initially contacted by the lawyer of the Gujarat Gujarat Pollution Control Board. I'll tell you in a minute the context in which she contacted us. She contacted Rohini Pandey to start and work with them. And here's the problem that India faces. India is probably has some of the most polluted people on Earth, places on Earth. You've seen Mark Zuckerberg jog in Beijing, and it started a whole hoopla. Actually, Beijing is much cleaner than most cities in India. Delhi and other cities in Gujarat that we are going to, and some cities in Gujarat are among the most polluted places on Earth. Why is India so polluted? It's not because they're not trying. India has the Water Act of 1974 and the Clean Air Act of 1981, which are modeled after the US versions of that. It has very strict threshold, and every state has a state-specific pollution control board, but the policies are not implemented. Basically, you have thresholds, you have policies, and then neither at the city level nor at the farm level do people really pay any attention to this kind of threshold, it seems. So we were interested in this issue of, you know, clearly there is a government that has a plan, is trying to get the pollution to go down, and what is happening in the plan, meaning that it actually doesn't work out, they can't implement their plan. So we have two projects with them, and I'm going to focus on one of them, which is the environmental audit system. This took place in Gujarat. Gujarat is the fastest industrial growing state in India. The prime minister hails from there. It's very, very polluted, as you can see from this picture, but more generally. Vapi, which is one of the industrial estates where we are working, is one of the 10 most polluted places on Earth. So they have two, the Gujarat Pollution Control Board, which is the government body that is in charge of that, has two instruments to control the farm's pollution level. One of them is direct command and control inspections, very familiar, and the other is an audit, third-party audit, which were imposed by the court some years ago. What is an audit? It's very similar to a financial audit in the for farms. Auditors must visit the farms 3 times per year. They collect pollution readings, for water pollutants and air pollutants, and they submit an annual report. And in principle, non-submission is punishable, and if you're very polluted, this can trigger some further inspection and the like. The problem in this system is that there is a huge conflict of interest, which is that the firm chooses and pays the auditor. So the auditor's main target is obviously to give the firm a good reading so that they can continue to work. So this is known, and there are, in principle, some guidelines to avoid the problem. But when we started, everybody, the government, the auditors, and the firm themselves, were kind of in agreement that the system was broken. Very much like there was discussion after the Enron scandal and the 2008 crisis that, for the same reason, our financial audit system is broken. So the reason I told you that I would tell you when we met the Gujarat, the lawyer. We met a lawyer in the context of a lawsuit that the firms were bringing up against the government, because the firm were saying, look, the data is so bad that you're not using it anywhere. So this is just a tax. You should remove the system. It was kind of ironical. They lost that suit. But this is just to tell you that everybody agreed. So what we did is, first of all, we collected data on what the auditors do. So this is what the auditors do. And you can see that this is the report as per the auditor. And you can see that the firms are very good, according to the auditor, as being just below the threshold. But what we did is we sent back checkers to university students to take measurements from the same firms a week or two after the auditors. And we found something quite different. This is the same firm, so this is telling you that there is some data that the system is broken. And then we worked with the government to reform the system, where a random set of firms that were audit eligible were sent a letter saying, hey, this year, the audit system will work a bit differently. You don't select an auditor. We select an auditor. We, the government, will select an auditor for you randomly for a pool. You're not paying the auditor directly. You're paying into a pool that is paying a fixed fee to the auditor. And in addition, the auditors were back-checked. So the idea is to remove the conflict of interest, first of all, and second of all, now the auditor's principle is society, and society has a tool, which is this back-check system. So this is what we found in the treatment, same measure, and you can see that now what the auditors report and what the truth is much more similar. It erases a lot of the math. Not all of it, but most of it. So this matters because this is the firm's actual pollution at end line, and you can see that the pollution declines among the very high polluter. Pollution declines a lot. So this is having a system that works helps to catch the very high polluters. So this was good. The next step was that, was it going to become a system? So it took some time because it had to travel through the court and the like. But basically, the GPCP accepted and enforced three main recommendations. First of all, randomly assign auditors to plant. Regulator set the fee for an audit. And monitor auditors reporting through back checks. Incidentally, if you notice what happened here, what is interesting is that in the back check, we found much more polluting firms, but we also found much more firms that are not at all polluting in the control group. The reason is that if you're going to make up the data anyway, there is really no reason to go and collect it. So you could actually just make up the report and then you make it up around the threshold. So the price for an audit in the status quo system is much less than you need to actually perform the audit, which would have been a sign that something was wrong. So now we randomly assign auditors to plan. The government assigned the auditors to plan. Regulators set the fee for an audit, which is sufficient to perform the measurement, and they monitor auditors reporting through back checks. So randomized trials, I think, have dramatically increased in number, scale, scope over the last 20 years, and they are now starting to play some role in the policy conversation here and there, trying to make a difference. Of course, there will never be all of it. Like, most of the policy conversation is, and I should say should be, dominated by what people care about, what they think about, what is important to them at a moment or another. And randomized control trials are never going to tell you that. What they can do, and have been, I think, in the process of doing, is helping government or government organizations do a bit better what they want to do anyway, and also provide some focus on what we know, what we don't know, and what we need to find out also in the policy discussion, which is there is a bit more we know, there is still a ton we don't know, and then when you hear the policy discussion, not in the US in the current presidential election, but in other setting, policy settings, there is, I think, much more willingness to kind of at least invoke the evidence as a part of an argument for going one way or another for a specific policy. Again, more on the detail of doing something than we should do education versus health, but I also think this is exactly the level at which we can be part of the conversation, at a somewhat technical plumbing level that is maybe under the radar screen of the large question, but is absolutely essential for effective policymaking. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your time for this.
It's not at all. Do you want to take three or something else?
So we have a couple minutes if there's someone who has a burning question. Carol. Sorry, we have microphones. I think the people at the back will have a hard time hearing you. Thank you.
Thank you very much for a great talk. I was interested in your kind of discussion of meta-analysis, really, because in a sense, that's what the medics have been doing for years. And with the medics doing meta-analysis comes a change in ideas about what counts as literature and what counts as literature reviews as well. So that when you do a literature review in medicine, you often have to do a literature review of the grey literature, which is essentially what you're talking about. So I wondered how you thought, that might change essentially how we do quite a lot of our economics research more broadly than just moving towards meta-analysis when you're talking in the RCT space.
So I think that the way we are writing economics paper is very, very different from the way they are writing medical papers. And although I have ups and downs on what I think of that, on balance, I think it's a good thing. I think our economics papers are much more interesting. The reason why I have ups and downs is that it also takes forever to publish something, and sometimes you think, you know, get on with life, just give me the fact. And I think that one thing that I would hope happens, and to the extent I can play a role in it, I will, but I don't know if I can, is to have some combination of places where people can put out facts in a way that is peer-reviewed, and some places where the fact goes along with the theory and the explanation and the narrative. And I think having places where you can put out facts on the one hand, and places where you, which are good places, like good journals, which give you some point for whatever tenure you need to have and all that, might, you know, play a role in this meta-analysis literature review kind of, they might be go hand in hand. My sense is that we're never going to go all the way there, probably rightly, and therefore things like, because we are also much more of a culture of working papers that are discussed, etc. So besides the peer review paper, there is a process in which things get vetted that are more in the conversation, and therefore we need a place for people to access unpublished research as well. And that's where I'm hoping that the registry will play a role. So that the published paper will have their own narrative around it, but even what is never published makes its way in registries and therefore makes its way in meta-analysis paper.
Thanks for a great talk. It's you can.
Yep.
Oh, good. Your first point up there, do results generalize from one context to another? You said it's an empirical question. And I wondered if it isn't also a place where we could want to understand the causes of effects. And I was wondering whether also policymakers wouldn't take your results or the results of these studies on board more quickly if they could, if one could explain to them why it is that an effect is large in one place rather than another. And as an econometrician interested in measurement, I wonder if part of the problem is that we don't measure these intermediating factors that are important in making something work in one place rather than in another place. Are you as pessimistic as you sound about the prospects for economics becoming like physics and being able to explain why things occur? So why?
I'm entirely pessimistic about being able to write down the full model, yes. But I am not pessimistic about theory of a particular local phenomenon in a sense of, like, so the reality is that, and, you know, the way you discuss the pertinence of a result is always with a model. The model is sometimes explicit and sometimes implicit, and it sometimes comes after the fact, and it sometimes comes before the fact, and sometimes the nice thing with things building on each other is that sometimes there is a study that has some, and then on the basis of the result on the study, you make up a model, but really the study is not the test for the model because the model came after, but the next set of studies use that model as a starting point. So the model is very helpful, in particular, to think about when things are likely to generalize, when they are not likely to generalize. So when you have something that's very complicated, like the ultra-poor analysis or even microcredit, I think at least at the get-go, theory is going to be, it's going to be difficult to use theory to know whether it's going to scale up or not, because it's just many, many things are happening at the same time. But what is happening now is that people are taking this many, now that we know that the whole package works, and it works again and again and again, it is worth it to say, well, can I take apart the package into pieces, and is that piece going to work, and that piece going to work, and that piece going to work, and this is what's happening now. So, and then there are cases where the interventions are simpler and where you can much earlier think about a model. For example, in the case of the auditors over here, it's very clear what is going on. We know that there is a conflict, we know the conflict of interest. There is a whole literature that helps us think about it. And this is that literature that tells us what we need to replace the current system by, and this is what we test. And therefore, in this case, I have reasonable confidence that another system with the same property will be equally screwy anywhere else you're going, and could be fixed with a similar approaches. So sometimes things are a little bit more streamlined, and you have more theory to think about when it will apply, when it will not apply. Sometimes things are a little bit more messy, and then I think we'll get to it, but it'll take longer, and it will be by a sort of combination. You know, things will accumulate slowly.
Okay, excellent. I think it's time for a break. Now, Esther's going to be participating in one of the special sessions this afternoon, so if you have other burning questions, you can hound her at that. But for now, let me just thank Esther again for a really excellent talk. Thank you.